When reports first broke 5 months ago of an explosion and fire on an oil rig in the Gulf of Mexico, the initial word was that no substantial amount of oil was leaking. The rest, of course, is history. The nation's largest oil spill, a catastrophe that led to major environmental and economic damage along the Gulf Coast from Florida to Texas. BP's Macondo well was capped in mid-July, stopping the gusher, but it wasn't until yesterday, after cement was pumped in from a relief well, that government and BP officials said it was killed for good. Retired Coast Guard Admiral Thad Allen was the government's point man on response for the entire time. I spoke with him a short time ago. Thad Allen, welcome.
Thank you.
Explain what's happened now, the difference between the well being capped and being effectively dead, as you put it yesterday. What's happened?
Well, we effectively shut in the well on the 15th of July when we put the capping stack on it. From that point on, there were no more hydrocarbons released into the Gulf. But what we had to do was permanently seal the well. There's always a threat of hurricane, and ultimately, you don't want any chance that any of that oil can get up from the reservoir to the surface. A while back, we cemented the drill pipe itself. What was left was the annulus, or that part outside the drill pipe between that and the actual formation. That required us to actually complete the relief well and cement it from the bottom, and we did that this weekend.
Effectively dead means to a very high level of confidence?
It means there is no path for oil to get to the surface through that well.
Okay. Is the well closed and off limits forever? Is there a chance that BP or someone could come back to it?
Well, that'd be a policy decision above my pay grade, but what's going to happen next is something that's actually called plugging and abandonment, because they will eventually fill that well completely. We've completely cut it off so it can't leak right now, but under the supervision of the Department of Interior, they'll go through a more formal way to completely fill the well up.
Now, in response, the president said the government remains committed to, quote, doing everything possible to make sure the Gulf Coast recovers from this disaster. Now, sitting where you are now, in your mind, what are the most important things that still need to be done?
Well, there's still oil out there. And there's oil in the marshes and around Louisiana, on the beaches in Mississippi, sometimes in Alabama and Florida still will have some come ashore. The next step is to completely clean up the beaches and the marshes, at least to the extent that we can without harming them. There are some times where you're better off to leave a marsh alone rather than have mechanical means being brought in there and actually harm the marsh itself. We're actually negotiating how clean is clean with each state and each
parish. How clean is clean is a negotiation.
That's a euphemism we use at the end of an oil spill to say, is there anything else we can do? And sometimes there'll still be oil there, but then the agreement is that there can be no more technical means applied to it, and we're all going to agree that this one is done as far as what we can do.
Well, in terms of the great unknowns out there, I mean, you say there's still oil out there. We still don't quite know how much oil, right? And we don't know how much of it may have settled on the seabed.
We know a lot about what's come ashore. There's a lot of controversy, a lot of talk out there about what subsurface oil may exist. I've been working very hard over the last several weeks with Jane Lubchenco to try and unify the federal effort. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, with NOAA, to unify the federal effort as far as monitoring for subsea oil with a lot of the state and local academic institutions in Florida, Alabama, Louisiana, and Mississippi to try and unify our data gathering so we can actually create a picture of what the Gulf looks like and where the oil's at below it.
Do you have any personal sense at this point about how much might be out there? I mean, in the seabed?
Well, I think there's a lot of conjecture. We've been taking data almost since the event started, and we find background traces of oil, and every once in a while we will find aggregations of small droplets, but it's usually in background or trace quantities. What we really need to find out is whether or not there's oil, say, in the sediment on the seafloor, out in the deep part of the Gulf, and we're putting together a unified plan to deal with that right now.
Looking back now, early on, of course, there was a sense that the government was too deferential to BP. They had the technology, we were told, so you had to work with them. There was this question of, is it a partnership or who's in charge early on? What did you learn? What did you and the administration learn about dealing in a case like this with a private company when they have the technology, but you need to be in charge?
Well, there were a couple of things that cost considerable angst to the country, and I understand that. The law that was passed in the wake of the Exxon Valdez, the Oil Pollution Act in 1990, requires that the responsible party pay. And if you're going to have them writing the checks and you're making decisions on a command center, they need to be close by you because you have to act in coordination. That doesn't mean that your decision-making is subordinated to them because you have an overall responsibility and accountability to oversee what's going on. You're right that the government does not own the means of production. to drill for oil wells, and the technology was used at the bottom of the ocean out there is very, very sophisticated in the hands of the private sector. But we created a science team headed by Secretary Chu from the Department of Energy and basically conducted oversight over the engineering decisions that were made and actually consulted with BP. And at times, if they weren't going the way we wanted them to be, I had to issue them orders to say, no, do this.
Were there moments of great frustration for you in trying to make that happen?
It wasn't great frustration, because generally I think the engineers from BP and our science team all wanted to head the same direction. It's just a different understanding from applied engineering for oil field engineers. And some of the folks on the science team, they were trying to say, have you exhausted all these possibilities? And I think in many ways, the BP folks weren't used to working in that environment, but that's what government was there to do, to make sure we were asking questions and they were giving us the answers.
To this point, do you think that BP has done all it said it would do? Well, what's your assessment of their performance now?
My assessment of controlling the well after the discharge is they've done pretty good. The problem was there was no existing mechanism to produce oil and bring it to the surface in the Gulf of Mexico, because it's all brought back ashore by piping systems, pipelines. They actually had to bring in production systems from the North Sea and Africa to develop that system that ultimately capped the well on the 15th of July. So from a technical standpoint and controlling the well, I give them very high marks. As far as understanding and dealing with the local population through a third-party contractor with claims and things like that, they're a large oil production company. And dealing with people one-on-one in transactions is not a core competency or capacity they had in the country and company. And that's the lens by which most people in this country viewed their response. And I think that was the center of where their challenge was.
And what about another relationship was between the federal government and the states? There were moments along the way of tension there where they wanted to do something. You had to assess it, sometimes saying no. Did you learn anything? Because you've been through several important disasters now in your career. Have you learned something about the federal-state role in something like this?
Well, I think so. I think we all found out that Tip O'Neill was really right. All the oil spills are local. And the way you interact with a state or a local municipality has to do with how they manage emergency operations, and that varies by state. The real complicating factor was that most of the states and local municipalities were used to dealing with us, the federal government, and FEMA on hurricane response, which basically provides grants to local governments and let them use the resources to do the response. In this one, there's federal primacy, and the coordination is done through the federal government. That didn't sit well with some of the local governments who were used to having the resources and being able to act freely. And it wasn't a matter that we didn't want to cooperate with them. It was a matter of law.
Has this all now, as you're stepping away from this at this point, has this made you rethink the safety of drilling at depths like this?
Well, obviously, we had a blowout preventer that failed to work as it was envisioned. I think we lacked response capability out there for dealing with the loss of well control at that depth. I think they've engineered a system now that could be the basis for response systems in the future.
I mean, we've learned.
We've learned how to create a response system to deal with an uncontrolled well at the bottom of the ocean. I don't think the response plans that were built over the last 20 years ever anticipated this would happen, and that was a failing.
But as you step away now, what do you say to the people in the Gulf? They're clearly going to have to live with this for a long time.
Well, they're very remarkable and resilient people. I found that out during the response to Hurricane Katrina. But they've had a lot of stuff laid at their door, and I think we need to understand that long-term recovery should be the goal. They have a way of life that's been threatened down there. And the long-term cleanup of this oil, the long-term recovery, making sure that the Gulf is restored to the way it was before this event happened, those have to be primary goals for everybody, and it's a national asset that we have down there.
All right. Retired Coast Guard Admiral Thad Allen, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.